terrorist nights, 90% of them were unarmed. These were not terrorists. These were people who had been extirpated from their homes and were trying to go back to see their fields, their families, and so forth. In 1956, when Israel invades the Sinai in collusion with the UK, your country, and France, Israel entered Rafah city, entered Khan Yunis city, lined up, and shot down dead hundreds of Palestinian men without trial, without any process. Forget about due process. Just line them up and shot them dead. You come to 1967 when Israel occupies Gaza in the course of the 1967 war. And now the Israelis are again determined to suppress, repress any Palestinian resistance in Gaza to the occupation. And under then chief of the Israeli Southern Command, Ariel Sharon, under Ariel Sharon, they commit new massacres in Gaza. The first intifada, which you are too young to remember, but which I witnessed firsthand because I was in the West Bank for occasion in Gaza, begins in 1987 in Jabalia refugee camp in Gaza. It's an overwhelmingly nonviolent civil resistance by all accounts, including my own personal account because I was there. It's an overwhelmingly nonviolent civil resistance. The first intifada, Israel engages in massive brutality to repress it. By 1991, Israel institutes in Gaza what it called the closure policy. And closure is just a euphemism for beginning in 1991, Israel starts to seal off Gaza from the rest of the world. By 2003, very mainstream Israeli figures. You take Baruch Kimmerling from the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. He's a senior a professor there. He describes Gaza as, quote, the largest concentration camp ever. Or you take Giora Eiland, who at the time was the head of Israel's National Security Council. And as far as any human being could be from a leftist and very close to a lunatic rightist. And Giora Eiland very casually observes that Gaza is, quote, a huge concentration camp. In 2006, Hamas comes into power. It's elected in a democratic election. Immediately as it comes into power, Israel opposes this brutal economic siege of Gaza, which is then seconded by the US and the EU. And basically it meant that no one can go in and no one can leave without Israeli permission. And few and far between were those who could leave. According to the South African application to the International Court of Justice, the genocide application, they report that over 300, close to 400 Gazans died because they were unable to leave Gaza in order to obtain better medical treatment. So nobody can go out, nobody can go in, nothing can go out, nothing can go in. At a certain point, Israel was keeping Gaza on what they called a humanitarian minimum diet, which is a euphemism for a starvation plus diet. And they banned chocolate from going into Gaza. They ban potato chips from going into Gaza. They ban notebooks from going into Gaza. They ban musical instruments from going into Gaza. They ban children's toys from going into Gaza. They ban any spices from going into Gaza. And they had a policy, a calculated policy, of keeping Gaza just on the brink of economic catastrophe, just on the precipice of economic catastrophe. And then if you fast forward to the night before October 7th, by that point, 50% of Gazans were unemployed, 60% of youth were unemployed, 50% were classified as food insecure, 80% were living off of government doles, government charity. That was Gaza. Now, there are two other facts that need to be brought into the picture. I have left out in my description so far that periodically Israel went into Gaza to quote unquote mow the lawn. And mow the lawn was the expression the Israelis coined for these periodic high-tech massacres in Gaza, the best known being Operation Cast Lead in 2008-9, Operation Pillar of Defense in 2012, Operation Protective Edge in July-August 2014. And in each of these massacres, hundreds and sometimes thousands of Palestinians in Gaza were killed, hundreds of children were killed. In Cast Lead, it was 350. In Protective Edge, it was 550 children. And then thousands and thousands and thousands of homes were pulverized, leveled systematically, methodically, with no armed conflict in play. Just neighborhood after neighborhood was roped off. It's all described in Israeli soldier testimonies. Roped off and demolished. They brought in the bulldozers and demolished thousands and thousands of homes. Bear in mind, 80% are refugees and children of refugees. And now their homes, what they managed to build in those 50 or so years since 1948, the 48 war, and now their homes are demolished. And it's important, I feel, in my opinion, to keep in mind the language. What is mow the lawn? It's taking in an implement with blades on it to mow the lawn. But brace yourself, 50% of the blades in Gaza are children. You're taking blades to crack the skulls of children. That's the metaphor. And that, to me, at the risk of sounding emotive and hyperbolic, that to me is testament to the satanic nature of that state. To coin a phrase like mow the lawn in a population that's half children. And it's precisely that kind of language that enabled the horrors that we've seen unfold since October 7th. So, if you've read, I don't say this proudly, but I do say it as a factual matter. I read the hundreds and hundreds of human rights reports on what has been done to the people of Gaza. And I could tell you with certainty the quantity of the death and destruction that we're now observing has vastly increased. The scale is just totally on a different level, but not the quality. The targeting of children, the targeting of medics, the targeting of hospitals, the using of civilians as human shields, the targeting of journalists, that's all old hat in Gaza. That's par for the course in Gaza. So there's nothing in terms of quality. There's nothing new under the sun. What has changed is this. Up until October 7th, Israel mowed the lawn in Gaza periodically. That is to say, wanted to inflict a high-tech massacre on the people of Gaza to remind them who's in charge. Since October 7th, they modified their strategy. Now, they don't want to mow the lawn, they want to extirpate. That's the fancy word for pull out by its roots. They want to extirpate all the blades of grass in Gaza. They want to, as they've said on many occasions, they want to render Gaza uninhabitable, unlivable, turn it into a howling wilderness.